Welcome, everybody, to today's talk, Poverty in America, an Anti-Poverty Agenda for the Next President, whoever he or she may be. I'm Elizabeth Donahue. I'm the Associate Dean here for Public Affairs and Communications, and this is our first public affairs event of the semester, so welcome. Today's talk is styled around a report. I hope you've received yours. We've given them out. It's titled Opportunity, Responsibility, and Security, a Consensus Plan for Reducing Poverty and Restoring the American Dream. And it was issued by a working group put together by the American Enterprise Institute and the Brookings Institution. And what's particularly remarkable about this group in today's age is that it is a consensus group, which really draws people from the political left and the political right to try to find consensus on such an important issue such as poverty. And I think we can all agree in this election cycle, it's a welcome addition to the discourse. Today's panel is made up of members of the working group, including Robert Doar, who is from the great class of 83. He is the Morgridge Fellow in Poverty Studies at AEI. He worked in the Bloomberg administration on welfare issues and in the Pataki administration on child support issues. Ron Haskins, who's a Senior Fellow of Economic Studies and the co-director of the Center on Children and Families at Brookings. I've also known Ron a long time. He worked on Capitol Hill on welfare reform in the 90s and has been at Brookings for quite a while. Sheldon Danziger, who's the president of the Russell Sage Foundation, and rounding out the panel is Judith Gueron, who's an independent scholar in residence and president emerita of MDRC. For those of you who know about poverty and study, you know that Senator Patrick Moynihan spent his career really trying to think of ways to ameliorate poverty, and so I just wanted to give a nice congratulations to Ron Haskins, who today was awarded the Daniel Patrick Moynihan Prize, which recognizes individuals who use sound analysis and social science research to inform public policy. And so it's really nice that you got that prize. And since we're talking about Senator Moynihan, I'll close by saying today actually is the first time I met Judith Gueron, but I often heard her name because I worked on welfare reform issues, and when you would go to a hearing that Senator Moynihan was hosting, he would often invoke Judith Gueron as Our Lady of Small but Significant Effects. And I think that's probably one of the best titles to ever be given. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to our panel, and thank you for being here.
Thank you. I always like when people applaud at the beginning because I've noticed over the years at the end, not so much applause. So I'm going to do two things. One, real quickly, I just want to say a few words about how the group started. I'm not sure most people on group, I think, might not even realize how it started. And then I'm going to give a quick summary of the report, and then for all the details and the real knowledge, the rest of the panel's here to fill you in. So Robert and I went to a meeting in New York City. It was going to be a group studying poverty. It had a lot of people. It was mostly, Robert and I are both Republicans. So there are Republicans from Princeton, I learned. I didn't really know until this thing that Robert had graduated from Princeton. And so this group was mostly left. And it turned out that the foundation who was paying for it pulled out after the meeting. They fired the president. Everything was amazing. So I called Robert and I said, Robert, you know, this is a good idea. The time is right for this. Let's formulate a group, except let's have it evenly balanced, left and right. We'll get great scholars to do it, and we'll publish a report in a year or however long it takes us on poverty and opportunity, reducing poverty, increasing opportunity in America. And Robert, of course, said, that's a great idea. Robert said AEI and AEI and Brookings are kind of like the most reasonable, the what?
Red Sox and the Yankees?
No, not at all. The AEI and Brookings both are pretty reasonable. Brookings is left of center. I'm not even supposed to say that in public, but I'm supposed to deny it. It's centrist, but we're left of center. The president of Brookings once said it to me, I said, have you ever counted up the number of people at Brookings who are in Democratic administrations and in Republican administrations? Because it's unbelievable. Anyway, and so there are actually people on the right, I bet at Princeton, you didn't know this, that are very reasonable. And most of them hang out at AEI. So Are the presidents of the respective organizations agreed? We formed a group. We met five times over 14 months in Washington and New York, and we started with 16 members. I think we only had one or two people that didn't agree. One of them was here, Princeton, because they were just too busy. But everybody else agreed. I was really amazed by that. And if you look at the scholars on it, it really is quite an interesting group of scholars. So after 14 months, 15 of the 16 people stayed with us. One person on the right felt that the right didn't get enough out of the deal, so would not sign the report. But everybody else signed the report, so it's truly bipartisan. And one of the things that we had in mind was to demonstrate that reasonable people who have spent their whole life on the left or the right could come together and cut deals on important provisions of public policy, and that's what we did. So the recommendations themselves, I think, are really worth studying because they're good recommendations, but the whole enterprise and the idea that people can come together and sign something, and there's nobody that signed that report out of the 15 of us who agreed with everything in it. And we knew that from the beginning. So, all right, so now let me give you a very quick summary of the report. Oh, here, look at that, they hid the thing. All right, so here's the logic of the report. Poverty's declined, but not enough. I need to clarify that a little bit, and I'll do that in just a minute. Economic mobility is stuck. We are not the home of the free, the land of the brave, and the land of opportunity. It's just not right. We've had very little increase in opportunity. There is some, but it's very minor. I'll show you the evidence on that in just a minute. We especially focused on in our group what we consider to be the three underlying types of causes of high poverty rates and low mobility, and they are family composition, work rates, and educational attainment. I don't think that's too shocking. And all of our work was concentrated in those three areas. So we devote a chapter to the trends in poverty. Then we have separate chapters on our recommendations in each of these three areas. And by the way, I'm sure other people will say this, but we felt that it was essential to attack all three of these areas simultaneously. You can't just pick and choose. You've got to do a whole bunch of things in order to make it work. In the end, I don't think any of us are going to talk about this, but we did talk about paying for our proposals because they do represent some increase in cost. So here's a shocking piece of evidence about the official poverty rate for single mother households, for all children, and for people age 65 and over. We made a lot of progress against poverty until the war on poverty started, and then, since then, not too much, with one exception. I'd love to launch into this for 5 or 10 minutes, and that's that single mother families. That is the group that's most likely to be poor. They're 5 times as likely to be poor as married couple families. And look at that big decline there. If you also look at data on increase in employment, which we'll do in just a minute, that it went up like mad. And it was associated with several events that occurred in the 60s, including welfare reform, but also the big expansion of the income tax credit and several other factors. So, but with that exception, we really have not made much progress against poverty. Now, these data are a little misleading. If you look at better measures of poverty to take into account all government benefits, which the official rate does not, then you will see that the government programs reduce poverty by about 50%, which is a decent accomplishment. But we still have high raw poverty rates, and even after government programs, we still have far too high a poverty rate. And the poverty rate among children is twice as high as it is among the elderly, so it's not good. Now, it would take a long time to explain this chart. I love this chart. This chart is one of the most fascinating data sets ever. In 1960, people at the University of Michigan started collecting data on 5,000 families, and they did it every year. Now they do it every other year. And then they collected it on their kids. So these data represent the actual children of a representative sample of the American public from the 1960s when they were approximately in their late 30s, early 40s, so during their prime earning years. And the question here, these are quintiles from lowest to highest. Those are the parents' generation. And then if you look at the bar graphs, what's in the bar graphs is the kids. Where did the kids wind up? So I want to focus on the one, just the one on the left, so ignore the other ones. That is the lowest income quintile. Roughly speaking today, it would be families below about $21,000 a year. And where did their kids wind up? Now, if we had equal distribution of income and lots of opportunity, you could argue that it ought to be 20% in each of those parts of the quintile. 20% of the people from the bottom should wind up in the bottom, 20% should move to the next quintile, and so forth. As you can see, it is not like that at all. The probability a kid from the top is going to wind up in the bottom is on the order of 6-7%. The probability a kid from the bottom is going to stay in the bottom is 43%. Equality, this is not. So we have a big problem, and it's just the opposite at the top. So we, I just don't see any way around. You just have to conclude that there is a big problem. Now I'm going to talk about each of these underlying factors just very briefly. So the trends in family composition are really unfortunate. We've had a huge decline in marriage. However, you probably don't know this at Princeton, but there was not a commensurate decline in sexual activity. And as a result of that, we had a huge explosion in non-marital births. This is a bad thing for kids. I've already said they're five times as likely to be in poverty from the very first day of their life. It's actually higher for, that's for all single mother families, but these are the most disadvantaged single mother families. So these trends are most unfortunate if you look at the, if you look at between 1970 and 2010 and look at the living, the family structure of women at age 35, as you can see, married with children, single without children, have all declined, have all increased, and single with children has exploded. And that's the very group that we're the most concerned about because they're most likely to live in poverty. And I don't know if any of us are going to talk about this, but we now have a huge literature, in my view, started right here at Princeton by Sarah McClanahan, which shows that kids from single-parent families develop differently than kids from married couple families. They are shocking disadvantages that they face because they're in single-parent families. So what about working wages? The trends for women are pretty good. We've had a big increase in women in the labor force, but we've had a long-term decline in men who are actually working. These are employment population ratios, so it's not like unemployment. It's people who are either in the economy or not. So they could be unemployed, but they also could just have dropped out of the economy completely. And we've had a long-term decline among men in working. It's hard to sustain a family if you don't have a family head who works. Fortunately, women worked. I already told you about never married mothers, a big increase, by far the biggest increase in any of these groups. And if you especially look at young black men, there the bottom has fallen out. Less than 50% of them are employed. And I ask you, how can you create strong families and strong communities when half of the young men in the communities are unemployed or completely out of the labor force? And the same thing is true of wages. This is really totally astounding. The bottom 50% of the workforce has essentially not had a raise in the last 30 years. Unbelievable. The top, great progress, lots of money, as you all know, and the further up you go, the more progress, the more money, but the bottom 50%, they haven't had an increase. Here's another amazing chart. This is the relationship in prime earning years between family income and education level. At the bottom line graph is high school dropout, then high school graduate, then some college, then professional or PhD. And as you can see, the lines never touch. It's always better to have more education. You can also see that the lines have gone further apart in recent years, and in fact, the bottom three go down or stay flat. So if you're going to make good money, a good living that would support a family, you have to have something beyond high school. Doesn't necessarily have to have a four-year degree, but you have to have something beyond high school. This is something we just have to face up to, and our policy should reflect that we understand that. So let's summarize what I've said so far. The trends in family composition, employment, and education are moving in the wrong direction for reducing poverty and increasing economic mobility. So let's do something. All right, so family. First of all, we have four major recommendations in most of these areas. This is a tough part of the report that we really had to bargain about, and we had some what I would call arguments. They were mostly fair, but once in a while, faces got a little red and so forth. So promote marriage. This does not work. It's unfortunate because it's a great thing. We need more marriage. I don't have time to go into detail, but we can talk about it during the question and answer period if you'd like. Promote delayed responsible childbearing. This we can do. We're very good at it. We should do more of it. I'm going to come back to that because I'm going to give you an example of each of these three areas. Promote parenting skills and practices. We also can do that. And we have data that shows that parents can learn to do a better job with their kids and that the kids get better as a result of that. We don't have good long-term studies, but for definitely for a year, some cases even more than that, helping parents do a better job of reading them more often, respond to them with advanced language, engage them in conversation, a whole series of things that we've learned to do. That would work if we did more of it. And then promote skill development, family involvement, employment of young men. So we ought to focus on young men. They are a big part of the problem here. And we have several recommendations for things that have strong evidence that they would work. Judy will talk more about the role of evidence in what we've done. So delayed responsible childbearing. Of these four, this is one that we really could make a difference, especially because of large, long-acting, reversible contraceptions. We've now had at least four big studies. One of them random assignment, most of them in states, but very big, thousands of people involved. And it is they show that first, women select large, long-acting, reversible contraception, especially IUDs, when they're given a choice, that's what they select. These are low-income women that get it free. And then the second thing is, once they take it, their pregnancy rates go down. And guess what? Abortion rates go down, too. So you'd think Republicans would support this. One of the biggest fights we had in our group is Republicans were very resistant to the use of LARCs. It's a complicated discussion, but we can have it during the question period if you like to work. So we have four recommendations here as well. Expand opportunities for the disadvantaged to improve their skills. That follows from the education data that I showed you. We should make work pay better for the less educated. We should expand both, and one of the recommendations there that conservatives agreed to was to increase the minimum wage. That was quite painful, but they agreed to it. The third is expand work requirements and opportunities for the hard to employ. So we would expand work requirements in government programs, especially food stamps. There are a lot of conditions on this, other people will discuss, but it was an achievement to get everybody to agree to that. And then we should make more jobs available. We have several proposals for how we could make more jobs available. The one I want to mention here especially is improving skills. The essence of improving these skills is that we should have ways to get low-income kids that cannot go to four-year schools to go to community colleges that are focused on giving them skills for jobs in the local economy that are available locally. Welding, computer repair, almost anything related to health, and these are often jobs that pay $50,000 or $60,000 a year. They're mostly not going to go away. We could really do a good job here, and we have recommendations for how we could entice the community colleges to play more of a role like this as well. And then last, education. We want to increase public investment in the two, what we thought, we all agreed, were underfunded areas, preschool and post-secondary. And you can read the rest of those there. I just want to say, focus for 1 second on preschool, because I think this is an area where the opportunity is really great. We have several good recommendations about preschool. But preschool is tough because it's been oversold. We've been saying for years that Head Start works, and the first time we do a big national random assignment study, it doesn't work very well. And state pre-K programs have a lot of trouble. We're spending between the federal governments and the states at least $30 billion on preschool now, including daycare. So programs that are explicitly designed to promote child development, and we could do much better. The keys are that we need better teachers, they need to be better trained, they need to be working with good curriculums, which most of them are not, and we have a lot of good curriculums now that have been demonstrated to for example, literacy, to promote literacy among young kids, and we need something called coaching, which is master teachers that are advising our regular classroom teachers about good practices with low-income kids and how to maintain order and all that sort of thing. So this is the report, the summary of the report, and now we have three brilliant presentations about more details in the report. So Sheldon's next.
Supposed to be. So let me start with a preface that I think exemplifies what we tried to do. In this report, we worked hard to get this consensus, and the first two bullets have two quotes from the letter I got inviting me to participate. And particularly the second one, we forswear ideological purity. We understand that the need to compromise and work together means that the final report is unlikely to be entirely acceptable to anyone. And Ron mentioned that. And in fact, on things, I'll get to, like on the minimum wage, we all agree that we should raise the minimum wage, but if you read the report, it says, you know, the progressives on the side were more than willing to endorse an Obama proposal that the wage go to 10-10 and be indexed for inflation or more, and the conservatives were not willing to go that far. So we just say the minimum wage is too low, it should be raised. So part of the way we got to compromise was to agree not to be too specific. So two things are relevant here. One, Ron and I both signed off on this report. We're both very pleased with it, and it has what's a consensus for him and me and for the group. Now, on welfare reform, if you really want to know what Ron and I think, it turns out while this report was being written, we had been asked, Ron and I, and Ron did his own, but since I'm a foundation president now, I needed help, and I did it with some colleagues from Michigan, have a point counterpoint on welfare reform in the most recent issue of the Journal of Policy Analysis and Management. And that's sort of the typical way these arguments typically go. So, you know, it was not quite Ron, you ignorant fool, in the APM, but, you know, that's sort of the normal process. And one of the reasons I was so willing to compromise is because a former colleague of mine and a very distinguished colleague, Ned Gramlich, was the chair of a Social Security advisory committee in the 90s. And in the 80s, there had been one of these commissions, and in fact, Greenspan was the head of it. I think Moynihan might have been on it. I don't remember, but in any case, in the early 80s, they reached a compromise. And for the young students in the room, because of that, your retirement age for full Social Security benefits is 67. It gradually raised the retirement age over a long period. That's effectively cutting spending. And it gradually raised taxes in a relatively minor way. I think almost everybody thinks that was a very successful commission, and it was a bipartisan compromise. Gramlich came along. The same thing happened in the 90s. There was a series of what would have been small benefit cuts over 20 years and small tax increases. That would be 20 years would be about now. And when that report came to a vote, it was sort of five people said, I love the spending reductions, but I hate the tax side. And five people said, I love the tax side and I hate the spending side. And so the final report, I think Ned and one other person voted for the report and nothing happened. And there hasn't been a Social Security, nobody even talks about it very seriously anymore. So I think some of us signed on because we thought it was important to do so. In the area I want to talk about poverty, I'm going to give you two quotes. The first one is the progressive side. These are both quotes from very important reports. President Johnson reported appointed a commission on income maintenance. I recently found out that Robert Solow, who's a Nobel Prize winning economist who spends some time each year at the Russell Sage Foundation, was actually a member of the group, and he remembered it fondly. When we talk about the causes of poverty, this I'd say is the progressive view. We've concluded that more often than not, the reason for poverty is not some personal failing, but the accident of being born to the wrong parents or the lack of opportunity to become non-poor or some other circumstance over which individuals have no control. And then they endorsed a negative income tax, which Senator Moynihan convinced President Nixon to announce, and it almost passed. And in fact, another reason why I wanted to be on was because, in retrospect, Nixon's family assistance plan would have been a much, much better solution to anything at the time, and it was opposed by the left and failed because the left said we can get much more after the Democrats take over in the 1972 election. So an inability to compromise. From the other side, this is an earlier consensus report. This one was mainly sponsored by AEI. And I'd say this is more of the view from that took off from Charles Murray in the Reagan era. And this is just the opposite of the other one. Money alone will not cure poverty. Internalized values are also needed. The most disturbing element among a fraction of the contemporary poor is the inability to seize opportunity when it is available and while others around them are seizing it. So one side says there are no opportunities. The other side said there are opportunities, but people don't seize it. And our report, we sort of said, okay, there are certainly those of us who feel more inclined toward the 1969 report. There are others who feel more inclined toward the 87 report, but we're going to try to come to something where we can all agree. And that's why, if you read carefully, when we come to work requirements in government programs, we say, okay, people ought to have more responsibility. They ought to be willing to take available jobs. And if they aren't willing to take available jobs, then they should possibly face their benefits being cut. But where we came together was, but we're not going to cut you unless an opportunity is available. And that means government would have to provide those opportunities. So the argument in some ways between the two views comes down to, why is the labor force participation so low? One side, people are unwilling to take jobs at available wages. The other side, people are willing to take jobs at available wages, but employers are unwilling to hire people like them because they've been long-term unemployed, because they have low skills, because they have prison records, et cetera. And so in the report, we come together and in a number of areas try to do this. I'm going to skip very quickly over this. I call this section Some Facts That Are Not in the Report that motivate my focus on making job opportunities more available. And I'll simply expand a little bit on, this is related to Ron's point about the median male worker not making any progress for about 40 years. I would just use this to say, this is why I think it's a labor demand problem. That is, opportunities are not widely available. It's because these are the median earnings of full-time year-round workers. So these are people who don't get UI, they don't get food stamps, they don't get housing assistance, they don't get disability, they don't qualify for anything. They're beyond the earned income tax credit unless they have a lot of kids. And the point is that, oops, I thought I was going to use the pointer. Is this the pointer? I won't touch this. At my age, it's best. You can point. If you look, basically, that blue line going up, when the war on poverty was announced, the people who were involved, Jim Tobin, the Nobel Prize-winning economist being one, thought that blue line was just going to keep going, that economic growth was robust, that it mostly trickled down, but not to the people at the very bottom. And if you had told anybody, I actually started my career as a postdoc at the Institute for Research on Poverty in the University of Wisconsin, the exact month when the data came out and said that median earnings, this is in current dollars, of men were $52,000. And if I had said to anybody there, oh, you know, the war on poverty is going to run into trouble because 40 years from now, male workers working full-time, full year aren't going to have any real increases. they would have said, you know, that's totally nuts, totally impossible. Well, that's what happened, and so in part that motivates my view that it's a serious problem of needing to make work pay. So I think Ron had these exact same slides up. This is, now I'm returning back to the report. These are the exact words of the report. And let me just take something where our group, this was like a no-brainer. This is, we argued about some things, but I don't think anybody argued. We all agreed that the earned income tax credit for people without children should be increased. I don't think there was ever any doubt. We argued a lot about lots of things, but this one was, and then people said, well, Congressman Ryan has a proposal to increase the EITC for single people, and President Obama has a policy to do that. And MDRC is currently doing a random experiment, and what we know from a lot of research on the EITC expansion that has occurred for families with children is that by and large it has increased work effort as well as raised wages, so that full-time, full-year people who earn the minimum wage and have a couple of kids, that earns, gets you about $15,000 a year, you get about $5,000 from the earned income tax credit, more if you live in a state that has a state EITC. So we all agreed on this. The reason we agreed on it is because how to pay for it, we were also willing to compromise. And if you read these again, these are, I'm trying to, when I talk about the report, I'm actually using the language of the report. We agreed that there would have to be some increase in revenue and some decrease in spending. Again, we didn't get into specifics, but we all agreed. So what happens in Washington, and Ron and Robert will know the details more than I, but my characterization of it is that Ryan wants to take it mostly out of social spending, and Obama wants to get the money mostly from raising revenue. Now, our group would say, okay, let's try to split the difference, and whether or not it's 50-50 or 40-60 or whatever might be an argument, but we basically said, okay, since raising wages in employment will make more men marriageable, it's more likely to get them to work, it's more likely then to increase marriage, which is another, and having two parents is good for the kids. This is a win-win, and we're willing to make this compromise. So I'm going to stop because I think probably my time is up. But the point is, I think the reason I signed on and everybody on the report signed on is a nostalgia for the days when in Washington reasonable people on both sides would get together. And when asked by some of my friends who were progressive and more progressive than I, you know, why did you sign off on this report? That's been my answer. This would not be what I would write down if I were going to be able to do it. But this is something I actually think you could probably get 60 senators and a majority of the House to agree on it if you could give them the report and let them vote in a secret ballot where their party members wouldn't know. So anyway, that's that's my story. And I think, Elizabeth, you're going to have to come and get Judy's slides.
Say a few things for starters on the factors that I think allowed us to come together, and I mentioned five on this side. and I'm going to concentrate on number four, but I want to mention the others. The first was that we agreed on these three values, and that already was a lot on opportunity, responsibility, and security. People differed on how much they thought responsibility was the key one, as Sheldon has alluded to, or security, but we agreed on that. We agreed on the problem, as Ron laid it out, high poverty, declining opportunity, all the gaps that he mentioned. We agreed on the need to act simultaneously on these three interlocking domains, that there was likely a feedback loop. Don't cherry pick one issue or another. Fourth, in red here, that we agreed to base our recommendations on reliable evidence and proven methods, and that's the one I'm going to come back and talk about. And the fifth is really that we paid a lot of attention to the process, and I think all of us would thank in particular Jonathan Haidt, who was a member of this group, who wasn't a poverty expert, but knew a lot about consensus building, and I think steered us, was very objective and steered us in a way that we got beyond some of the conflicts that we had. Oh, so the important thing on that number four is what was new. We had reliable evidence. I said before that we agreed to base our recommendations on evidence, but that can be a lot of hooey if you don't have any evidence. If this group had been meeting, and Sheldon talked about the 70s and the 80s, if we'd been meeting then, a lot of what we talked about would have been based on hunches, anecdotes, there would have been a lot of cynicism, nothing works, and there would have been disputes about whether any of the research was believable and discussions about methodology. And at that point, even calling a social program an investment with a known payoff would probably be dismissed as an oxymoron, investment social program. Second, since then, researchers, including people at Princeton, an early one was Orly Ashenfelter, in government, in foundations, in an organization like the one I headed, MDRC, really transformed that evidence base. There was a big investment and 40 years of effort. And an interesting thing is that seeking reliable evidence was never a partisan issue. MDRC was set up during the Nixon administration. Republicans, Ron, when in the House, were always fans on smarter government basing decisions on evidence. What changed was that we knew how to build that evidence. And now we know, as a result, a lot about what works and doesn't, and how to get answers to that question. And that evidence, from randomized controlled trials and others, was generally respected by this group. People did not argue. There were no disputes when there was rigorous evidence. There were basically no disputes on methodology, disputes that had plagued earlier such discussions. Why isn't this working? It is. Okay. So the fact that I at least think, and I think possibly the others here, that our agreement was really in part a payoff to those years of investment in evidence building. I don't think we would have been able to agree without that kind of evidence that some approaches actually moved the needle. They were investments with a payoff. This wasn't just hopes and dreams. And that you could, in fact, implement quality research designs that told you about causal effects, and that this data really mattered. What happened over these years was really the demonstration that you could test social programs, like in medicine, people test drugs using randomized trials, and that when people talked about research, it wasn't talking as advocates. We really moved social sciences more toward a science. So I think the ability to get together was a triumph of testing and building knowledge. And the other element in the report that's interesting is when we were uncertain about what to do about an issue, people didn't plunge ahead with a hunch or a hope. They talked about testing and evaluating and basing actions, implementing things at a scale that could, and you would learn from the process of implementation. So I think that evidence area really underlies the report. Now I'm supposed to say something about education. Ron already talked about the problem that education levels are increasingly associated with income, and since the 1960s, almost all of the income growth has gone to people with BAs or advanced degrees. And there is this increasing gap in achievement and attainment between the rich and the poor. In thinking about what to do about this, we had a diversity of knowledge in our group, and we really tried to draw a line on what's been learned about brain development and what affects it, and on the gap in cognitive and language and socio-emotional development that begins at a very early age. There is some data in the report that were really depressing and startling about how as early as 9 months there's a gap between low income and middle class and wealthier children in low income families. And we also tried to base what we were doing on the evidence of success of some interventions and whether and not only were interventions successful, but they were scalable and they could be affordable. So we came up with four recommendations. The first was to increase the investment in two underfunded stages that Ron mentioned. One was early preschool, but really before preschool, starting in infancy. So we talked about marshaling the pediatric primary and prevention areas and improving also the quality of childcare and daycare. The second area was post-secondary education, and we were fortunate here that there were some studies of programs that had really shown how community colleges could be organized to more successfully get people not just in the door, but to complete, to stay there and to complete. And we referred to one program in New York City called ASAP, which stands for Accelerating Study in Associate Programs. I mean, it's a very clunky name, but it requires students to go full time, it's free, it provides a range of academic supports, and resulted in from a rigorous random assignment study in showing a near doubling of graduation rates over 3 years. We had three other recommendations. The second was to promote soft skills development, socio-emotional learning, which we considered vital to success in the labor market later and in school while people were in school. And we talk about more resources going there, higher standards in states and localities, and setting up centers of excellence in which teachers can learn how to do this. A third was modernizing the organization and accountability in the education system. And we talk here about experimenting and evaluating on how you might do this. And finally, to close the resource gap between schools serving the middle class and the poor, and in particular, not just to get more money to poorer areas, but to reverse what we saw as a growing socioeconomic segregation of students. And it was interesting in today's New York Times, there was an article about efforts to do this in New York City. And the report talks about the increasing segregation of students into schools that don't have heterogeneity in this area. So that's in brief what we said about the education area. And I'm going to turn to Robert to talk about families. Thank you.
So notwithstanding the fact that I went to Princeton, I was by far the least academic of everybody on this group. I come from the practical world of social services agencies in New York City and New York State. And so I brought that perspective to it, and I also don't have a PowerPoint. So I'm going to just talk about a couple things. The first thing I want to say is that the emphasis on all three was extremely important to all the group. I want to repeat what was said. It's not just employment and labor market and the economy. It's not just schools and education and training and college and pre-K. And it's not only family. It's all three. And any effort to make progress in reducing poverty and increasing opportunity needs to do all three. I also need to say that it was important to the group to make a strong statement about the flight from marriage and the weaknesses in parenting practices which appear in non-married poor households, and that needed to be addressed, and that we were immensely informed by the work of Sarah McClanahan here at Princeton. I was in one meeting, I have to admit it wasn't one of our meetings, but I was in one meeting where a bunch of scholars were discussing the peculiar gap between the percent of children born to married unmarried families among college educated or higher. That's something less than 9%. For percent of children born to mothers of high school education or less, it's more than 50%. And someone was saying, well, how did this big gap in Americans, how did that happen? Or why? What accounts for that? And someone said, well, the college educated kids have read Sarah McClanahan. I don't know if you can prove that, but there was some sense to that. But the group wanted to make a very strong statement about this. And one way to address that issue of the flight from marriage and the disparate impacts and the negative outcomes for kids in single-parent families is to be very clear about promoting marriage. This is probably, in one way, maybe the most controversial thing we said. But we said emphatically, we need to promote marriage and promote the benefits of two consistent and committed parents together for the long haul in the effective raising of children. Now, in the United States, that is much more likely to happen within marriage. Now, I have to also say that when we talk about promoting and talking about and pushing and reminding, this is kind of the bully pulpit recommendation. And there is some skepticism, and was some skepticism, about the effectiveness of that. But from my perspective in social services programs in New York City and in other areas, there isn't any question that when leaders and cultural norms and messages from politicians, church leaders, academics become united on a certain issue, change can happen. It can happen, and there was some willingness on the part of the group, both left and right, to agree to that. And I should also point out that here the dynamic was kind of interesting. For a long time, people on the right have talked about family and marriage and the importance of two-parent families. Here, those of us on the right felt very strongly that we weren't as effective as we could be. In fact, it wasn't clear that anyone was really listening to us. And then when we're talking about the communities we're trying to help, having the left with us on this issue was extremely important. So if more kids were raised in households with two committed and consistent parents there for the long haul, poverty would go down and opportunity would go up. And we as the leaders in this field were willing to say that strongly, and we do in the report. Now, we also say make three other recommendations with regard to family, and I was going to begin this talk by saying I have four things to talk about: marriage, family planning and contraception, parenting, and fathers. So in the second, family planning and contraceptive, Ron already mentioned, there was a strong willingness, both sides of the panel, to say that young people need to have access to and counseling about all of the most effective forms of contraception, so that they can make better decisions and more effective decisions about how to plan becoming pregnant. And there was divide on that because people on the right were concerned, and I think some on the left as well. And I should also point out that my first drafter on the family chapter was Ron Mincy, who is a scholar at Columbia University, who I've worked with for years. And he also had some concern about the government being overly pushy with regard to one particular form of contraception that may upset the power dynamic between a government entity talking to a young woman who is seeking counseling on contraception. But we definitely took a stand on the importance that counseling availability be available so that young people could make better and more successful decisions about having children. Finally, not finally, the next 2 points is parenting. Here again, evidence-based focus is very important, and parenting education is tricky. But there have been some signs that some programs like the Nurse Family Partnership, which was something that we did in New York City and is done around the country, can be effective in helping that parenting gap be closed so that people who are raising children outside of marriage can have better success in getting children off to a good start. So there's a lot of talk about parenting. And then finally, helping young men in difficult communities. One of our colleagues, Ron Mincy, strong, long-standing commitment to helping men in poor communities get greater attached to the labor force, better interaction with the child support enforcement program, and greater sense of what we call work supports. There's a portion in the chapter that talks about the different situations that a single mother in a poor community faces with regard to the welfare system. So a single mom with two kids will be eligible for a very generous earned income tax credit if she goes to work and works in a minimum wage job. Very generous, $5,000. She'll be eligible for food stamp benefits. She'll be eligible for child care assistance. She'll get child support collections and the services of the child support program. Similarly situated young man or the father of the children who doesn't have the children in the household really gets very little. The commission, the report took a strong stand that we need to balance that a little. We need to bring the same benefits of work and work supports to men who are often the fathers of the children we were concerned about. So I want to associate myself with all the comments about the benefits and the joy of coming together and the extent to which I think it is different than what is going on mostly in Washington these days. Although I will say that I've been very pleased by the reception of the report, and that I think ideas like the earned income tax credit for childless adults, I also happen to believe that a focus on family and an understanding and a willingness to recognize that children do better with two committed and consistent parents, and we shouldn't be afraid to say that, has been generally well received. So I'm hopeful, and I hope that we can have a good discussion and dialogue about this for the rest of the session, but I also want to say that it was really a great pleasure to be involved in this effort because there are, if you look at the report, look at the authors, all of the authors and all of the participants are people who have a long history in doing and making contribution to in a evidence-based, focused to help struggling Americans. And Ron, I think, started us off right. We've made progress, but we still have a long way to go. So thank you.
So we have about 15, 20 minutes to do some Q&A. Students, I'll call on you first.
So I want to ask, I think, what might be a little bit of a sensitive question, but I really think it's worth kind of talking about. I think when we talk about this sort of longing for the good old days in Washington, right, of compromise and those kinds of things, and I say this as a former Senate staffer who really misses those days a lot, it was also pretty extraordinary, particularly for women, people of color, things like that. And I wonder if, as we sort of try to hearken back to those days and all the good things that it brought, there are dangers too. And I noticed that the authors of the report, and it's an amazing report. I think it's going to be incredibly helpful. They're 95% white, I think, and 80% men. And does that have an impact on what ends up in the report? So marriage incentives, marriage promotion ends up in the report. I didn't see a lot of focus on criminal justice.
No.
Well, I think that the, these are things are hard to put together, and I think we would have liked to have a little more diversity, but that's how it happened. And I think that we did choose, isn't any question that some difficult issues were chosen not to be talked about, and let's talk about things we can come to agreement on. So that's what I would say about that. I mean, I think the diversity issue went both, I think, with regard to gender and race, but also with regard to width ideologically. We don't have very, very, very extreme conservatives or very, very extreme progressives, in my judgment. So we made some decisions about that and put it together and got people in the room and got started. And I think that you're right that there are issues that might have been tackled if we had a different group, but these are the ones we felt comfortable tackling.
I would add to that I don't think the women on the group were chary of expressing their opinions, and that in particular, at one point, the discussion of marriage moved from a man and a woman to a committed couple, and that was a change, and things like that happened. Sure. You can always, you're balancing a lot, and getting the left, the right, and the center into the group was a primary focus. But I think the women were not shy.
I would like to say one other thing about that. It relates to the current political dialogue, the politics going on in the country. It's possible that the whole country is not with us, that it's very left and very right. I don't really think that's true. But we could have been sort of whistling past the graveyard, as the far left has a big, whole, comprehensive set of solutions, and the far right has another group of solutions.
I think the way to have a productive discussion about this, or at least one approach, would be to identify the issues that you think would have been more addressed if there had been more blacks or more women on the group. One issue I can tell you about that we didn't necessarily start, it was going to be in the report, was family leave and sick leave and so forth. And Jane Waldfogel, who is one of the women on the group and as ferocious a person as you could possibly ever have an argument with, was bound and determined there was going to be, and it's in there.
Elder, did you want to talk?
Yeah, I guess it's a bit of a follow-up on this. So I want to separate between evidence-based and what the evidence then suggests we ought to do. They're not the same thing. So as a simulation, let's assume for a moment that your clients, the poor of America, met to issue a report. And they agreed with all your evidence. And they would say, yes, it's true. It's very hard to be a good parent as a poor American. Let's do the following. Let the rest of America become more empathetic and more generous and provide us with basic support systems that the rest of the Western world seems to provide. After-school programs, childcare, transportation, all the stuff that all of Western Europe gives the poor. And we'll be better parents. Another one. We know it's true, single parents have big problems and their children are handicapped. We agree with the evidence. What should we do? Give our men reasonable jobs and don't put them in jail. Let's reach barely the levels that the rest of the Western world has adopted, and we'll be better families. So, I mean, the evidence is there, but your conclusion to teach people to be better parents as poor, struggling Americans with two jobs is slightly comical.
That's fair, but I just would say this comes from my perspective as a social services commissioner for the last 15 years. We've done a lot of promising to poor families that we're going to do that. We're going to do what you suggest. We're going to fill the gap with increased government spending and better schools and better child care, and we haven't. And my judgment is I don't think we really are. I felt, and I think the commission felt, or the group felt, that it was important to say that we had to be honest about what is possible in government and what family needs to do as well.
So let me say, go ahead. So Elder, as I say, I'm going to be a Talmudic with the text here. There is a section on reconnecting disconnected men. So part of that would get at some of the things. As a group, we couldn't get people to go as far as we would want, and so I'll read you some of the text that at least shows that we're thinking about it, and that's why I think the agreement is important. So I have been a fan of jobs of last resort for the poor since Gottschalk and I wrote America Unequal in 1994. So here I am on a commission with Larry Mead, somebody I first debated in 1987, and as far as I know, we never agreed on anything, but we agreed on the language on the section ensuring jobs are available. And we said some of us would also support public service employment during overall economic expansion in parts of the country with persistently high unemployment rates, subject to the other restrictions mentioned above. Others believe that such a step would only be appropriate if coupled with significantly stronger safety net work requirements, and that other policy tools are better suited to help workers living in depressed areas. So if you read it, we all said we're not doing enough for the disconnected men, and we ought to do more. We weren't going to get this group to say we ought to move toward a European-style safety net. I mean, the first quote I gave you from 1969, that president's commission, that was the closest I could find any government documentation of something that sounds like what all the European welfare states had accomplished shortly after World War II. So I don't disagree with you at all. What I say to people who say, you know, this is so modest is it's better than the status quo, and I think taken as a whole, it would make a significant impact. Several percentage points of poverty in the short run, and then if we hope the long-run effects of raising employment and earnings trickle through family and education, the educational changes, then there'd be bigger changes in the long run.
Can I, and let me just add one thing in for the sake of reality. We spend about $1 trillion a year between the federal government and the states on means-tested programs. And it was for many years, starting with Johnson, that almost every year we increased not just in constant dollars, but in spending per person in poverty. That has stopped, and I don't think it's going to change, except Medicaid. Medicaid is the one exception. But all these other programs, we are not going to spend more money. In fact, there are several studies now that show very clearly that we're spending less on children now than we did 3 years ago, and it will continue to go down. It's being crowded out by spending on Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, and interest on the debt. And we haven't done an inch to change that pattern. It's going to continue into the future, and it's going to continue to eat the rest of the budget.
Hi. I had a question in regards to the promotion of marriage policy. I think, as we all know, the overwhelming number of children raised by single parents are raised by their mothers. And there's an obvious demographic group that is not becoming involved in parenting. And so why did you decide to put the emphasis on promoting marriage rather than promoting paternal involvement in the children's lives? Because that seems sort of, I mean, if it is too stable or too involved parents that you're looking for, it just seems a little.
Well, I'm gonna try, and then the academics can pipe in. There was a lot of effort to talk about that. The problem is, and I've worked in promoting parental involvement 15 years. The problem is there's not a lot of data that shows that cohabiting or absent parents and single moms can close the gap some other way. That there isn't enough evidence that programs that can just do that and not mention marriage or can lead to outcomes outside of marriage that come close to what happens in marriage. So the group, I think, felt that it was important to be honest about that. As hard as you look at it, marriage does matter. And until we find a data set that shows that households with involved absent parents, and there are a lot of them in the United States, can close those outcome gaps, we were reluctant to put a lot of emphasis on it. At least that was my position.
Well, I'll read the text, because Ron Mincy is not here. I thought it was in here, but it is. To help non-resident fathers better provide for their children, improving responsible father programs should also be a priority.
Yeah, so, I didn't say we shouldn't do that as well, but the reason we focused on there in addition was that we need to help. I mean, let's be clear, there's a lot in there about helping absent parents be but we weren't going to just do that.
So the answer should have been right from the very beginning. We recommend both. Not that we think either one's going to work very well, but we need to focus on it as much as we can. Another point here, and Sarah McClanahan again, and especially her wonderful study on fragile families has shown this so clearly, there are monster barriers to fathers staying involved. What happens is they're not married in the first place, they break up within 5 years, something like 60 or 70%. The mother goes on to new relationships and often has children with the other men. And so you have other men in the household, you have kids from two men. It's a situation that is not conducive to the father having much influence, and a lot of them just give up. I don't know how we're going to overcome that, but it's way more complex than you can deal with in a report like this.
My question was concerning one of the first charts you showed on the official poverty rates in children with single mother households. And I was wondering, there was a market decline, it looks like about 1992 to 2000. What was the cause for that, and did that have any influence on your recommendations?
In poverty, there's a big decline in the 90s, and it's because the work rates among never married mothers who are the most likely to be poor increased 40%. That is the biggest increase in the history of Bureau of Labor Statistics over such a short period. And then since then, they've gone up and down a little bit. They're lower now than they were in 2000. And the reason is we've had two recessions, including the worst recession. And an irony here is that when mothers are committed to working, they're subject to the same economic forces. They can't just live on welfare like they did before. They were somewhat insulated. They were poor all the time, but they were insulated from the ups and downs of the economy. Now they're not, because so many of them work. And so you can see, if you look at, I showed the data, but I didn't call attention to it, but if you look at the employment population ratio for single mothers or for never married mothers, it has gone down. It came up a little bit after the 2001 recession, but before it could recover completely, then the big one hit, and they went way down, and now they're coming back up again. But they're still much higher than they were before welfare reform, and poverty among female-headed families is much lower than it was before welfare reform.
Sorry,
don't take my
sorry,
microphone.
Sorry, sorry. I just didn't answer your
question.
You're
not even a Democrat.
Answer your question. Three things happened: welfare reform, required work, EITC expansion, rewarded work, and the economy was booming. Those three things contributed to a significant increase in work rates for never married mothers, which led to a decline of child poverty for children in single parent households. We are not in that world right now. We don't have an economy that is really in the same status it was in the late 90s. We still require work, but we those are the three factors that led to the decline.
So, I'm looking for students. Yes, go ahead.
So the first speaker mentioned the particular challenges facing young black men in the job market. I come from the city of Milwaukee, where over half of black men in their 30s have been to prison or jail. And so we all recognize the structural challenges they now face trying to get back into the workforce, trying to become active in their families with a criminal record. Did you guys talk about these types of challenges and what kind of systemic reforms could be implemented to deal with the truly, I think, unique, intractable circumstances and challenges that black people particularly face?
The answer is yes. We were very concerned about incarceration. We were worried about dealing with too many issues. We still have things about incarceration in there. I think you probably know that there does appear to be a good chance we're going to change the federal laws in the next year and back off on mandatory sentencing and so forth. I think everybody agrees this has been, to my view, a kind of a national, almost a triumph, that at last we have agreement that we went too far, we put too many people in jail, and they have huge problems. We mentioned ban the box so guys could come out of jail and at least get to an interview and get started on a job.
We had
so many recommendations, we tailored them down a little bit. It's mentioned in there, the group definitely supported Ban the Box, but
I think there were two issues that incarceration was one and immigration was another, where we could have spent a lot of time and we just couldn't spend a lot of time. So we knew they were key issues, but didn't focus on them.
Cities and states should also consider passing and enforcing Ban the Box ordinance, which forbid employers from asking about criminal records in written applications. So
my memory's not as bad as I thought.
Yeah. We weren't. The process of this was remarkable, and that's why I keep going back, because we had, you know, to caricature, Robert would say marriage, 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 and I would say guaranteed jobs, guaranteed jobs, guaranteed jobs, and then we had to...
I'd say evidence.
So that's why I think before the first one of these I did, I went through and I've marked it up and, you know, recalled, because I remember this person thought this was very important. And when we disagree, there will be things like, you know, everybody agreed that incarceration was a serious problem here. We've got a section on reconnecting disconnected men, and the most disconnected are high school dropouts who have criminal records. That really disconnects you from the labor market. So when I said this, I said this to somebody, and then they got upset. I said the report is fair and balanced. Because they thought that meant something else.
Okay, I'll go the very back row and then the next row down. So let's go back to back.
Appreciate you coming. This is a great report. I'm enjoying kind of skimming it as we talk. And I was wondering about if you have much to do about worker rights and responsibilities. It seems to me that a lot of sort of modern jobs, that's been really hollowed out, even among kind of skilled labor. There's sort of webs of contracting, lack of benefits. As an absurd example, I read about Subway sandwich makers who sign non-compete clauses if they leave the people working fast food for a year. I mean, it's this sort of crazy endgame where the worker just doesn't have a lot of power, even if they're within a job. And so I'm wondering if you have an answer to that. It seems like it'll be really important going forward.
There is one line, I won't go look it up, where as a cause of the problem, it says changing employer practices, and I remember because I got that put in. But I would say something, this is off the record for the report. It's not the report. If you read Tony Atkinson's book on inequality and what to do about it, and watch on the Russell Sage website a video of Robert Solow and Paul Krugman talking about it, and then also read something by Joe Stiglitz, which came out of the Roosevelt Institute, called Rewriting the Rules. Among very mainstream economists, Nobel Prize winners, for example, there is, I think, an emerging consensus that employer practices play a very large role in the economic stagnation. Now, our group wasn't writing about the causes of wages and what to do about median wages. But I think to reinforce what you'd say, I just refer, there's 20 years ago, more economists were saying it's globalization and labor-saving technological change. I think people believe that's very important. But I was, as somebody who reads this, I sort of thought, gee, when I was in graduate school, we were taught let the market do its thing, and then you reduce poverty and inequality with taxes and transfers. And on this tape, you'll hear Solow say that's not enough anymore. And if you read Atkinson's book or Stiglitz's book, they'll say the same. So that wasn't our report, but I would endorse your comments.
I was just going to say thank you again for the report and for the presentation. Of the wish list of policies that you want to see, I think the big elephant is in the room is DC and just our political environment. Wondering in terms of what is actually realistic, what is actually going to happen, and then how can institutions like AEI and others, either on the left or on the right, begin to rein in a lot of this dialogue? Is it what Professor mentioned before, empathy is the first place to start, or what do you see and how do you go about it?
So the big news in this discussion, in my judgment, is Speaker Ryan. He has decided to make poverty one of his four priorities of his speakership and his agenda for the coming year. And the one issue that he talks a lot about, and he gets cited a lot about, is expanding the earned income tax credit for childless adults. And the president mentioned it the other day at the State of the Union and said, I'm pleased that Speaker Ryan is talking about that. But I think it's also fair to say that while Speaker Ryan brings a lot of oomph to that discussion, he's not there yet. His conference is not there, and I don't know that he'll be able to pull that off without a lot of horse trading going on with the administration. And so there's some greater talk and interest among Republicans on these issues. There's the criminal justice reform, I think, which has got bipartisan support. And there's Speaker Ryan finding particular areas that he cares about. On the Republican side, they also feel strongly that there needs to be greater focus on work in the SNAP program, and that there's an increasing number of people on SNAP who maybe could be working but for some reason aren't, and why aren't we doing more to help them, leaving aside a requirement, get into the labor force. So with regard to the organizations, Ron will have to talk about this more. We do what we do. We produce reports, we write out beds, we blog, we criticize, we run down to Congress and tell people they're doing things that we think are bad. But politics is politics, and what's going on in the presidential election, in my judgment, isn't helpful right now. The one way of looking at it from my perspective is that leading Republicans decided some time ago that this was an issue they cared about and wanted to do something about. They laid some plans, they started doing various initiatives all around, and then the campaign started and it got sort of taken away, and sort of an example of the best laid plans go awry. So we're waiting for that air to pass. That would be my judgment.
Okay, I'm not overly optimistic. And in this situation that we have in Washington, the thing to do is to savor small victories and fight for them. Small victories, not big, enormous changes. So one is going to be the EITC, I think. It could be financed by changes in the tax code. Ryan wants to change the tax code. I think if we had reasonable changes like we had in 1986 in the tax code, the EITC for childless workers will be expanded, because I think both sides agree on it. I think there's a very good chance for changes in incarceration and especially mandatory sentencing. There's some chance, this is where I think things would really start to melt down. The Republicans are very much agreed that they want to give more power to the states and the localities and take it out of Washington. And the temporary assistance for needy families and welfare reform we've been talking about is a prime example of that. It gave a lot of authority to the states, and there are very good arguments that the states did not do it well. And we have many people now, especially single moms, who would have in the past been qualified for a cash welfare benefit who are not getting it. There's just no question that that's actually happened. So I'm worried about state flexibility. And then there are things that nobody ever talks about and not in the paper. I think we're going to pass an extremely important child protection provision this year, which is going to open up new spending for prevention and treatment programs. The administration's proposed it. There's a lot of agreement on the right and the left. I think we could pass something like that. It would be very important, and you never read about it in the paper. Same thing with child support enforcement. There are a bunch of little things we could do in child support enforcement that would be effective. So those are the kind of things that we need to look for and savor.
The most dangerous thing I've seen in their reaction to the report was a number of columns that picked up on what was just mentioned, which is adding work requirements to the food stamp or SNAP program and letting it go the way of TANF. And that is not what the report says, but it came across in at least two or three op-ed columns about that the report did say that. And, that would be such a misreading of what we advocated in the report that it really is distressing. And it's in some sense ignoring the evidence or the report's focus on don't take that plunge without the evidence, and just picking up on what Ron Haskins just said, the history after TANF, which is often celebrated as an enormous success, has left many people who ought to be receiving benefits without them.
We have time for one last. You've been very patient back there. So, yeah.
On the topic of marriage, are there any studies and reports to show the impacts at different income levels on family is not together?
The income, the different,
different
income,
income
levels.
Effect on the children or effect on what?
On the outcomes for poverty. I mean, obviously the lower income of breaking up with family is going to have a bigger impact. But I think from some of the questions, there's difference of opinion between sort of the moral question and the financial question. So I just was curious, has anyone, are there studies to say even at upper income levels, there's a negative impact financially?
I think the most interesting studies on this that I think are worth reading, which I'm sure you all, are the Chetty reports on mobility, which tried to take out and seem to indicate, whether it were for boys or for families in general, that that among poor families, outcomes for single parent households are not as good as they are among poor families of married households. And so that's what those are the ones that are getting the most attention.
More the
level. Higher level.
But what you're saying, what I think you're saying is, even in that income group, an intact marriage does better for mobility. Than
yes.
Than
yeah, and then we have a reference to the mobility.
Yeah,
study.
I want to just say one thing here. It would be very hard to do this kind of analysis because the incomes among the poor change so dramatically and so often. It's really hard to get. In those charts I showed you, that was the incomes were averaged over 5 years in adulthood to try to get a stable measure. So it's really hard, a family poor 1 year, next year could be making $30,000, and next year making $10,000. So it's be hard to generalize.
Okay, we could keep going for hours, but we can't. So thank you.